of a question, is it possible to be agreeatory? I'm Robert Washington, and you're co-convener of Mount Royal Size 2, the conference of which this is a part. And I want to introduce you to the moderator of this panel, the editor-in-chief of the Calgary Herald, Lauren Motley, who will take over from here. Thank you. Recently, Dr. Lysack was awarded the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council grant, for which he is the coordinator of a team of NGOs, community and business leaders, and academics in three provinces, including Alberta. This project is focusing on education and engagement of decision makers and the community to encourage the ramping up of renewable energy generation. Prior to this, he was the leader for the now completed SSHRC-funded project Alberta Acts on Climate Change. Dr. Lysack has been awarded funding grants for a province-wide video conference with 28 sites throughout Alberta regarding community leadership on renewable energy. In February 2008, he initiated and organized the first teach-in on global warming and climate change at the University of Calgary. Please welcome Dr. Lysack. Our next guest really requires no introduction, but I'll give it to you anyway. Preston Manning served as Member of Parliament from 1993 to 2001 for Calgary Southwest, and really important to this crowd, it's my friend. He founded two new political parties, the Reform Party of Canada and the Canadian the Reform Conservative Alliance, both of which became the official opposition. Mr. Manning served as leader of the opposition from 1997 to 2000 and was also the party's critic for science and technology. And in 2007, he was made a companion of the Order of Canada. Prior to entering politics, Mr. Manning owned and operated a management consulting firm specializing in long-range planning and communications in the energy sector. Mr. Manning has published two books, The New Canada and Think Big. I saw on the table up there, the biggest there. He has also served as a senior fellow for the Canada West Foundation, a senior fellow at the Fraser Institute, and a distinguished visitor at the UC and University of Toronto. Mr. Manning is president and CEO of the Manning Center for Building Democracy, a national not-for-profit organization supporting research, training, and communications initiatives designed to achieve a more democratic society guided by conservative principles. Please welcome Mr. Manning. So you understand how it's nice to work. So the two parts, the first hour, I'll say, well, Dr. Lysack, Mr. Manning will have a debate centered on the question, is it possible to be pre-Torah? You should understand the spirit of this event is for it to be a respectful dialogue. I expect to hear differences, disagreements, but not rhetoric designed for a 30-second attack soundbite, which we in the media are too often for all of us in the audience, this is a wonderful opportunity to use their instincts to build on the ideas presented. Following this first hour, we'll turn the questions over to you. So you can see there's a couple of microphones set up in the crowd. We put on notice that those microphones aren't there for long dissertations from the crowd, and straightforward to the point questions will be, I put, rewarded. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Lysack and Mr. Manning to begin. Dylan.
Actually, I'd like to start with a quote, and I'm not going to tell you who it is, although you'll be able to guess, I think. But it's a quote that I found that I think really frames this very well. I'm interested in what you think of this. Now, the choice we face is not between saving our environment and saving our economy. The choice we face is between prosperity and decline. We can remain the world's leading importer of oil, or we can become the world's leading exporter of clean energy. We can allow climate change to wreak unnatural havoc across the landscape, or we can create jobs working to prevent its worst effects. We can hand over the jobs of the 21st century to our competitors, or we can confront what countries in Europe and Asia already recognize as both a challenge and opportunity. The nation that leads the world in creating new energy sources will be the nation that leads the 21st century global economy. Any guesses who that was?
No, I wouldn't answer it. It's usually dangerous to guess.
It was actually Barack Obama. And on Earth Day 2009, he addressed a number of factory workers who were, until that point, unemployed. It was a Mayfair tag producing washing machines and dryers, and then was transformed into producing wind turbines. And he used that as a page to kind of plant some of his ideas. But I'm wondering, does that frame it well for you? Or what are the things you like, and what are the limitations?
Well, I guess to say what I don't like, not that it's in my statement, but I don't like to see any polarization between the economy and the environment. I think it's a false dichotomy, and it gets you nowhere. And the American political culture, as you know, is different than ours. There is this inclination to polarize everything in the political arena. And until very recently, that was productive in some respect because they go to the corner and have it out, but then come back towards some reconciliation or compromise. In recent years, I haven't seen that happen in the United States. I think that's dangerous, and I think in particular in relation to this issue, that the object should be to reconcile economic and development and environmental conservation, not to polarize.
Okay. So how would that look in terms of how you see the relationship between the two?
Well, to get to the question on the advertising for the diversity group, is there such a thing as a green Tory? So I guess I would first look, are there people who have reconciled their economic development and their economy and the environment? And I know in my personal experience, there are such people. And here in Alberta, we got a great example. These eastern slope branches, if you send out a political scientist to analyze it from a political standpoint, where they stand on the political spectrum, they'll come back and tell you these are the most walk-through fiscal concerns you'll find in the country. You know, balanced budgets, no taxes, the ranching sector has resisted government intervention, they are doing more than any other sector of the agriculture. So on the one hand, these are these new concerns, but on the other hand, if you know any of those people, they are almost fanatic and protecting those grasslands and aquifers and woodlands. So what are they? Are they blue environmentalists or are they green concerns? So I guess I say I find individuals who have done that and sectors who have reconciled those two, and I just wish there was some way of finding whatever's in their DNA and spreading it around. Moving to the political arena, there are a few conservatives that I know in the federal parliament who have this integration. The Bob Sopak, the member of parliament from Dauphin, Swan River, and Bob's been a long-time environmentalist, biologist, his pedigree is very long, and an activist, not just talking about it, doing it as a farmer, an organic farmer, but at the same time, he's a conservative land, as a conservative, elect as a conservative, so respecting every conservative caucus. So I'm saying there's individuals who have made this reconciliation, and I just wish there was a lot more.
Well, and there certainly seems to this past year, especially last spring, spring time, the federal budget seems to be aided and so on. There seems to be, when you talk about this polarity that emerges, there seems to be more of that. I mean, I remember how Thompson and John Fraser, both were environment ministers in conservative governments federally, raised concerns around the fisheries, the impact on the fisheries. Bob Mills, who I think was...
Bob's another example of one of these. He was a biology teacher and the environment was too long before he ran for the
reform party. Yeah. And I know that he was quite concerned about the elimination of the National Roundtable and came out in the public, I'm sure you remember that. And then Mark Perron, in terms of being the former Nova Scotia professor and certain environment minister, talked about the natural capital to your environment unless you preserve it. You don't get that money. And I was fascinated to see these little sort of surfaces of people clearly who had a strong commitment to protect the environment and also strong conservative.
Well, your biggest problem in Ottawa, I think, and this comes from the political strategist, is, and this is true of the conservatives, but it's true of others, they conceptualize certain issues as either sword issues or shield issues. Sword issues are ones in which you're prepared to go out there and crusade and invest your political capital in making something out of. Shield issues are ones that you almost do enough before you start. See, the other people will occupy the high ground or we can't win on that. And so you don't, you take just a defensive posture. You aren't positive and proactive, you're defensive. And you hope you can get to an election by fuzzifying the issue enough that it doesn't become a major factor. And unfortunately, I think in Ottawa, I think in Edmonton too, on the conservative side, that the environment and also healthcare reform have been conceptualized issues. And when they get into that category, it is extremely difficult to persuade people to kind of abandon their defensiveness. If I'm rambling on too long, you can stop me interrupting. But I used three arguments with my friends in Ottawa, particularly, as to why conservatives should be more positive and proactive on the environment. The first one is, I say, that conservation, some of you have heard that before, so I don't know that, but I say conservation, conservative, come from the same root. So they're not philosophically incompatible in that basic sense. And secondly, I asked the fiscal conservatives, what's the central principle behind your fiscal conservatives? Well, it's living within your means. Well, living within your means is basically an ecological principle. You can't put greater demands on a system than is unnecessary to sustain. And so I say to them, well, then you believe in living within your means fiscally. Surely it's not a big jump to believe in living within your means ecologically. balancing the ecological budget. But I had a little discussion, I guess it was a debate with David Suzuki on that. And I thought if living within your means is a conservative principle, then I'm a conservative. And you had a young guy with a camera there, we actually got David on saying that. And David, if you're going to type something to appear in the commercial center, that's better. Election, you can actually do that. But that principle of living within your means, like if fiscal conservatives profess to do that, she cannot be brought to that into the environment. And then the third thing, and the thing I try to persuade, because there's not successfully, is conservatives profess to believe in markets. And markets can be harnessed to environmental conservation. I mean, a market is a pure market from a common standpoint, it's just a system that brings supply to bear on demand using financial incentives and price signals. The market doesn't care what the demand is. It can be a demand for oil or automobiles. It can be a demand for clean air, clean water, reclaimed land, or whatever. And so I say to the conservatives, why don't you make your own harnessing market mechanisms to environmental conservation protection? So those are the three kind of philosophical arguments I've tried to use to break down this. You don't have to be defensive origin. Proactive and compatible with your principles in that way. But say it's a hard sell with the older, but you make more yards on that with the younger.
Well, that's interesting because there is this psychosocial research. There's people who call it.
I was a little worried when they said you were the psychiatry. Might be applying to that. I might need psychoanalysis.
I don't have your informed consent to do that.
Okay.
But there's this distinction between settlers and prospectors. So, and prospectors, that would be people who are very interested in their own personal benefit. They're very short-term thinkers. They're interested just in their own lifestyle and convenience and so on. And but the settlers, and here's where I think that some way of thinking of these as being conservatives are people who have a strong sense of fairness, of morality, of restraint. So the idea of restraining your appetites, which is an old conservative idea, goes back to certainly Burke and Russell Kirk and others. Smart spending, traditional values, community benefit. And so as you were describing, you know, some of the people that you thought personify this community, we consider it, well, I wonder in some ways if that they fall into that category. And so if that's true, I wonder if there's really a distinction between a conservative and an exploit attitude, or a prospect would be more of a person who is interested in that or not. But is that, would that be a helpful distinction, do you think?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, in the most general term to this, it's always a challenge to get political people that kind of think long-term about anything. It's partly because of the election cycle that they're into. They're relatively short time horizon. And also the impact of the media on the media has an attention span of a couple of seconds. And it's the questions and the images from your media are always on. You give a speech on the long term, yeah, you can test this out, and I've done it. You give a long term perspective type speech, and you just watch the media take over. You're not giving us anything. I got an editor that wants to hear something that's relevant within the next 6 hours, within the news cycle. You give something that is within that cycle, and it's okay. And so there's just a number of factors that work against the long term.
At what point, were there one or two turning points for you personally that where you became quite interested and concerned about protecting the environment?
Well, I can tell you three instances. The first thing, I started at the University of Physics, and then I couldn't have the math, so I went to economics. But I started on physics, and you know, one of the simple laws I understood was the lot the conservation engineer has, but whatever you take out of nature, the total sum of it is what's going to go back in one way or another. And you might appreciate, you might not appreciate the story, but anyway, in 1970, when the Alberta passed its first environmental, I think it was the act that established the Environment Department, the Edmonton Journal ran a contest called the Dirty Story Contest. And what they wanted you to do was go and find an irresponsible industry that was belching smoke or whatever, preferably with a picture, and write a 250-word essay of it. Whoever had the best picture and story won the prize for the Dirty Story. So, knowing the law of conservation energy at that site, I knew a couple of guys working in the basement of the Edmonton Journal at that site. I asked them, get the two numbers, how much newsprint did they use per day? And how much, in those days, they used that black carbon beam, which was full of real bad stuff. How many barrels of that did they use? So they got me these numbers, and I took them to an unemployed campus, and I said, you work this back into the woods, that much pulp, or that much paper, how much pulp, how much effluent, how much excess waste wood in the forest, how much biological demand in the streets, etc., etc. And then said, and then you work it forward the other way. Assume that product all gets oxidized sooner or later. Let us take 30 years production, 300 days a year, and let's get the figures, how much CO2, how much CO, how much. And then when you burn that black ink, you produce all kinds of interesting stuff. So I got all these pictures and put them into a 250-word story. And the journal said there's this innocent back in the banks of North Saskatchewan, the things that appear to the driven snow. This is the amount of junk that place is responsible for. And we gave it to the electronic media, who didn't have a field day with it, and the journal canceled the story. Or canceled the contest, so I didn't read it. But Ross Monroe, who was a fine journalist, one of Canada's best journalists, was the publisher of the journal. And so Ross talked, I was just the young fellow, he thought that I was behind this scheme, and summoned me to his office. So I went in there, and all he had was a desk, a clean desk, with the papers in there. And I came in, he didn't even say hello. He says, what can I do about it? He says, do you know what the advertising rates of this paper would have to be if we did whatever you're talking about we should do in the woods? And he says, do you know what the subscription rate of this paper would have to be if we had to, you know, pick them up and recite in those days you didn't do anything? And I said, well, that's exactly right, but why don't you tell me we use that? That is the case with every compound business and industry in the country. They all produce this junk like you produce it, and they can do something about it that's going to cost. But that's the real issue here. And then I went one step too far, and I had a consultant from it, and I said, I'll do the material balance study for you for $50,000. And at that point, he threw me out of his office. So that was my first, and I actually, because I was coming at it more from the physics standpoint, that was my first experience with what I now understand to be full cost accounting, trying to think that through. And then I shouldn't go ramble on this, but more recently, and I think this is the key, if you want to influence oil companies, executives, politicians on this subject, they may be hard to spin when you come at them philosophically or as an interest group, but there's a way to get to them through the kids. Because I've asked all the executives who take a pretty hard position on this, do your grandkids, would they subscribe to what you just told me and then the awesomeness comes through? You don't know. The kids are more sensitive about this and they care about it. They want it to care. And so in our case, so my oldest son is our family environmentalist. We used to take the kids riding in the Cypress Hills. And he fell in love with that part of Alberta. That's one of the most unique parts of the prairies, the Cypress Hills. And think of that buffalo grass down there that's never been broken. And a few years ago, we, on his urging, acquired some ranch land down there where we're developing organic. We got a herd of galloway and cattle, and we were raising them organically. Preserving that grass at considerable cost because it's going to take a long time to be profitable. So I've been very much influenced by him. He took the graduate work at Louisiana State University from professor that believed that people's attitudes in the environment were shaped more by culture, by art, history, and sense of place. They would study the impact of French and English literature on people's attitudes toward nature. He did his master's thesis on the Greek and Hebrew roots of the Western environmental, and so he's had a big influence. And then the last one, I'll stop, but we got 10 grandchildren, sent to so. We have looked after, one of our daughters in Calgary has 4 boys between the ages of 7 and 14. We look after some kind. One of the youngest ones, 2 years ago, I was getting him to brush the teeth, and I turned the tap on and was chasing him to get him to brush his teeth. He says, "You wasted water." And he gave me a little 30 seconds, but I'm like, sure, just run around. This was, I think he was 7 at the time. So, although I find policy interest and a science interest in this issue, I found that the younger generation, our own children, now our grandchildren, have probably had more influence on trying to respond to their concerns about this issue. And it is a good way into the heads and, I guess, more into the hearts of some people. Otherwise, you can't crack at a philosophical level or a political level or even a science level.
Well, that kind of emotional connection, I think, that you're describing so well, is very much my own journey.
Oh, was it?
Yeah, so when I was in Ottawa and first getting a job in a teaching position here at the university and then finding out that I had one, I was reading a book called Weathermakers by Tim Flannery, and for about 3 nights, especially in the middle section about describing what the impacts would be on the Arctic and the wildlife in the Arctic and the way of life in terms of our native peoples there as well. And then that produced for me a bit of a kind of a crisis of conscience and career, because here I was, University of Calgary decided, yes, we want you to come and be a family therapist and develop this program. And yet the question, here I'm kind of borrowing this very literally, no pun intended, from Thoreau, but basically this kind of, what good is it as a well-adjusted family if you don't have a decent planet to push them on? And I thought, there must be something that I could do. So then my wife and I came here to Calgary, and I found in the faculty social work, the freedom and the support to kind of find my own path, to kind of extend social work, so it included this environmental side. Social work, of course, has some interesting advocacy, some engagement. I'm afraid to use those words, and I'm quite proud of them. It's a strong tradition of community practice, of public education. So all those things are certainly there. But of trying to find ways of pushing the envelope further and further out, so that we could include this other dimension, and kind of discovering what I think many other professions, medicine, and others have known for quite some time, that there are connections between our relationship and our connections with the environment, or broken connections, and our sense of well-being. And that was one piece that became very important to me.
Well, the issue from your angle on, I go with a fair number of conferences, conventions where this issue is being discussed, that a lot of the solutions to the environmental challenges, including from environmental groups, focus on the supply side. If we could only produce energy in a greener way, technologies, and which is good, and that's one way to come at it. I find far less emphasis on the demand side. Like, is it not ultimately necessary to reduce in absolute terms our demands for goods and services? Now that's not a particularly popular message with them. The other message is easier. Like, you can keep demanding whatever you want, and we can somehow fix the technology. But when you're dealing on the demand side, you really are dealing with a very fundamental human desire to acquire your gift pretty quickly to greed. And I'd be interested from the more sort of sociological standpoint, psychological standpoint, how do you get people to reduce their demands in the absolute terms?
Well, one way that I think that I've been exploring, I don't claim to have all the answers, but I think it offers some really valuable potential is E.O. Wilson's notion of biophilia. Mm-hmm. E.O. Wilson is arguably probably our greatest living biologist. Harvard recently mm-hmm. retired from Harvard. And he developed this idea of biophilia. So bio meaning life, philia meaning love of life. And as you may know, there are several words that we use for love. So which is family love, agape, which is very other-centered love, eros, which of course is romantic or sexual love. But philia is this notion of kinship, of deep connection, partly by choice. So what Wilson argues is that from when we're very young, you know, if you watch a child playing, and maybe it would be pre-linguistic in some ways, and when they see an animal, even like something like a bug, what happens? They're riveted to it. They're transfigured by this. And this sense of deep connection to life and life processes, Wilson says, is something, it's like moms being attracted to horse life. You can't, it's an intrinsic part of our nature. For scientists to say something like intrinsic is quite something. So what he suggests, it goes for a whole lifespan. You can sort of see that young children have that. As we grow up, we read stories of lots of animals. You know, we think of all the fairy tales of Narnia and all, I mean, all kinds of books and, of course, now movies that have and myths from many different cultures that have animals and nature, major parts of it. Some of them are religious.
But how does that translate into a reduction in demand? Does that end up in that?
Well, see, what this ends up being, I think, is a recovery of our wanting to protect something that we deeply care about. And because I think that simply applaud, like appealing to reason alone, like in an abstract sense, like you should do this. And we've had a lot of campaigns like that, and they do have some success. But there's also this other side of when people have this sense of attachment to nature, and often it's a particular place or a particular species or part of nature, and they have stories about this, and it's part of their family history. I mean, I was thinking about that as you were talking about your environments, like Brazil's and so on, is that I can imagine that in your family, not just as individuals, but as a family, you have this sense of real commitment and love of the land. And if we can be, and I think people have this by nature, if this is a way of building greater motivation, then I think that motivation becomes a foundation for being willing to consider that we need to make choices, especially when we're looking past our children.
Where I thought you were going, I don't find myself disagreeing with what you're saying, but maybe you can get to self or to producing demands from Phillips. I was wondering about the agape, the self-sacrificial love. I actually believe that the religious communities, and I have made a deal with the Christian ones, can play a role on this demand reduction side. In fact, when I speak there with this audience, I said, maybe you guys can work on the demand side, and it's consistent with your faith, self-sacrifice in a greater cause. There's going to have to be some self-sacrifice, you're taking less deliberately in order to reconcile man to nature. And this is an underdeveloped area, I think, in the environmental movement, partly in the United States, because religion and faith get polarized into polarization. But I think there's a lot, and I have noticed the circles I operate in religiously are enormous conservative Catholics and evangelicals. And these are people that they have in their tradition, the tradition of Christian stewardship, of what we have to look after the land as a spiritual obligation, not a political one or an economic one or something. But I think it kind of got lost for an awful long time.
another example I think of that is that I've been building some very tender connections with some Muslim community, for example. And I asked them, how do you frame this? Because the Quran is very clear about there will be signs when humanity is abusing the earth and so on. They talk about it as a duty to service. But when they talk about duty, because like, he looked at me and I could tell that he thought that I was kind of not sure what he meant. But for them, duty of service is a joy. It's something that involves for them the sense of the fullness of life, the depth of life, comes from having that restraint, because that's a better life rather than having more stuff, that you have a quality of life and relationships with people. And I think that's something shared not just by the religious tradition, but we have all kinds of Confucianism, wisdom traditions, many cultures, but it's been kind of covered over by identifying consumerism.
Well, I think that's where you can explore is harnessing the faith communities to the environmental side. So yeah. It's appropriate that maybe we can switch gears to one other concept that if I could promote only one concept that I thought would move the environmental protection agenda along, it would be this, and there's folks here that are more expert with than I am, this concept of full cost accounting. That, and I use this with, I talk with the energy folks, and the petroleum industry is being forced into this by regulation, that in the production of any good that's just confined to energy, there should be an obligation to identify what the negative environmental consequences of that production are. To identify what has to be done to avoid it or mitigate it, and to integrate the cost of those avoidance or mitigated measures into the cost of the product. Full cost accounting and pricing, and using the pricing system, a market mechanism to constrain the use of that resource. And I think the adoption of that concept, at least by energy policymakers and regulators, will go a long, long way to integrate what you do with the environment, energy production. And you do get around Calgary, you're getting grudging acceptance of that concept. You know, there's some attempt to go, you're more confused with this, but I think it is starting to get grudging acceptance that partly because it's the regulatory regime, the legal regime is moving that. But the point that the oil patch guys make, which I think is very valid, is if you are going to apply that concept of full cost accounting and pricing to us, you have to apply it to every other energy source. And so, in Alberta here, the oil sands people get chastised for tearing up a couple of hundred square kilometers of forest in Northern Alberta, and they are doing that, and slowly obliged to reclaim and post environmental laws, so it's kind of getting an economic incentive or a penalty for not doing it. But as they point out, the hydro companies of this country were seen as clean as a group of groups, so have flooded forest areas the size of Lake Ontario. So where's the reservoir tax for the hydro tax? If you don't have a carbon tax, well, there's a reservoir tax. Where's the radiation tax for the nuclear? Shouldn't be that don't produce a lot of CO2, but they produce one of the most deadly poisons known to man. And the cost of decommissioning a nuclear plant is five times what it is to go to the first place. So where's the radiation tax? And where's the environmental levy on the wind side and on the solar side? Because there's no energy form that is environmentally neutral. And in the end of the day, I mean, there's still going to be, relatively speaking, hydro is going to be cleaner than all costs. It's probably going to be cleaner than petroleum and wind and solar. But the difference won't be between sort of 0 and 1,000. It'll be between, so on some scale, between 400 and 600. And I think this promotion of the concept of full cost accounting and pricing is one of the, convince energy policy and regulatory people to go down that road more systematically, that it would do more to force this acknowledgement of the environmental consequences of what your economic activity is doing, coming up with avoidance and mitigated measures, and integrating into the cost of the products with the money to finance the avoidance and mitigation. And I've been in all kinds of debates with this, and there's all kinds of objections to it. Like, it's not that easy to measure some of the things. But I take the evolution of the national economic accounts. When the national economic accounts were developed, there was lots of things you couldn't do. You didn't know how you value intellectual property. How did you do that 100 years ago? Well, they didn't know how to do that. But they did not develop the national economic accounts because you couldn't take care of this fact or that fact. And so the idea that we can't measure some of these things properly or adequately shouldn't be a reason that we don't try and down the road. So that's what my hobby horse is. I'd like to actually get a big, just an open letter to energy policy makers and regulators and get it signed by everybody left and right, environmentalists and industry people, saying one thing we could do is, it's the old thing, if it matters, measure. So let's start doing that.
Well, what are the prospects of that happening through scheduling, given the current already and provincially given up for it? What's your political sense of that? How feasible that is? Do you think a lot of pushback?
Well, yeah, I think when I raised this with the federal fellows, and of course I didn't progress on in the heart of the section, of course, but they think, okay, so you're going to increase the price of every commodity in the country at a time when our economic recovery is so shaky that, so that there's that, and that's it's a hard argument to answer. But my answer is, you can start in some area, and you're not going to be able to overnight the entire economy, but you can start in some area. I actually think I found more receptivity to it from the industry people. The industry, they hate the uncertainty of it. That's one of the reasons the double entry bookkeeping was created. Reduce the uncertainty of it. So I actually see more receptivity for some of the industry people. And I think the way industry is regulatory, more through the regulatory machine, to start applying that in particularly regulatory periods into major energy projects, is just a concept out there. And because it, like, in financial accounting, like, it would be absolutely ridiculous to have one financial accounting system for the manufacturing sector, another for the mining sector, another for the finance sector, but you couldn't allocate capital rationally, nor would the pricing signal send any kind of rational message to consumers. And yet that's kind of what we're doing in the environment. We don't have a uniform accounting system for environmental impacts of the pricing. And the sooner we get there, I think the better.
Well, and I think that's often used as one of the bases for attacking, say, renewable from certain quarters is that it too doesn't involve some of those that it obscures the fact that in subsidies like for nuclear power, which is a ratio of 10-1, and certainly oil and gas companies have had a long history of subsidy. And then the problem becomes, okay, well, how do we get a kind of level playing field? And Michael Chung, was a minister in Stephen Harper's cabinet at one point. This is kind of argument that he would, I mean, you and he are going to get along very well, because he says, we actually don't really have a true market economy with a level playing field. It's very unlevel. But we need some way of shifting the economy so that it does provide an opportunity for those who are business people on the other side.
Well, I think the proper accounting system is one of the first steps towards unveiling the field. What are the field costs? What extent are these costs? What's subsidized? What extent are they not taking into account? But in looking at different potential audiences or receptors for that concept of the political types, the industry types, or the regulatory arena, I think the regulatory arena might be the better place to start.
Yeah, I have kind of another idea, and we talked about this when we met a couple of weeks ago around looking at the German example in particular, but this approach has been used in many, many different countries. punitive taxes that you somehow focus on the overlayers of financial wars. So, I mean, these are some interesting stats that I just want to put out there, that from 2000 to 2011, Germany increased the proportion of their electricity coming from renewables from 5% to 20%. And they had a target of trying to get to 30% by 2020, which is not that far away. But now they're upgrading it and saying, well, we can actually get more than that. We can get to about 38%. And their long-term goal is to get to about 80% by 2050 and to phase out nuclear entirely by 2022. And you have a large company, Siemens, which of course does a, does a lot of our C-train cars or other forms of transportation. They've announced in September 2011 they're getting out of nuclear, saying, this is a quote from their policy, Germany's shift towards renewable energies is a project of the century. So what they've done in Germany is this policy of feed-in tariff, of basically requiring energy producers to take all forms of renewable energy. So if you put a biogas or some kind of biomass thing on your farm in Cypress Hills, or if I put on solar panels on my house, that the companies are obligated to take that into the grid. And then there's this price structure which fixes it at a certain level, so it gives security and stability, which you mentioned earlier. And it actually transforms ordinary people into not just being consumers, but being producers of energy. And what they found in Germany is not just they've had this explosion of renewable energy that they produced over 340,000 jobs. It's the most resilient part of the economy, live in the car industry in Germany. But the consciousness of people, this is maybe getting back to your other question, that by say, having these hundred thousand roofs in these phases of getting more and more people engaged, that when the Christian Democratic Party came in with Merkel, a little bit more conservative, and they were going to try and cut the feet underneath from some of this, communities rose up. People were farming and agriculture, they're used to harvesting the sun or harvesting the wind, or using biomass and taking the methane to, you know, to heat their homes or heat the cities. And so, well, so 78 to 80% of Germans say, even though we pay a little bit more, which actually amounts to about 40 euros a year, because we want to do this for our children. That's the most common comment. And I have this kind of vision, and I'm both kind of encouraged to try and be bold. Why is it, or why couldn't Alberta, instead of being known for its oil reserves, why couldn't it be known as the leader in green renewable energy around the world? We have some of the expertise which could be built up, solar exposure, because of the wind. And there's nothing inherently anti-conservative or anti-anything else to embrace and to really support those business people who are developing
that. Well, I mean, well, certainly you learn from those models. I think the challenge with the consumer is it is true that there's a certain type of consumer who will recognize environmental agreement and pay for it. But there's an awful lot of other consumers that won't. Like in Alberta right now, our electricity rates are fairly high by the national standards. And the public opinion survey on that is that there's a fair amount of pushback on that, to the point where Alberta's deregulated energy sector, there's a lot of pressure for re-regulation, basically driven by the squabbles over transmission lines, but also by the high rates. But so it maybe comes back to some of the things we're talking about earlier. People will value the environmental protection that they're getting and pay the price for it. That it works. Years ago, before I ever got to politics, I was in the consulting business, mainly with regulated energy in the enterprise, electric utilities and gas utilities. And I used to be invited to these sessions with the vice presidents of the company, and my role stir things up, stimulate the discussion. So I went to one of these for Calgary Park, which is now kind of out. And I said, why don't we split the company into two companies? The one produces kilowatt hours, produces energy, and the other company offers environmental protection. It's the one that cleans up the stuff going on the stack. Separators in it, more than you were. It's the one that retains the land out of walking where they're digging up all the coal. And those days, you used to have what was called rate-based rate of return rate regulation. You separate the assets of the company into different categories. And you could actually separate some of the major assets that were used for environmental protection from the ones that were used for the park. And then my idea was that you flow this right through the customer. So if you're a customer of Calgary Cars, you get your car, you get your bill, but it's in two parts. Here's what we're charging you for the park. Here's the charge for environmental protection and conservation. You want us to fill this tank 3 miles high, other walking, so that we can really treat that flue gas. We can do it, but here's the cost to separate the production side of the environment. So needless to say, I've gotten nowhere. But it's a little bit like that, and presenting the consumer, if the consumer was willing to pay for a greater degree of environmental protection, a way to get at that and a way to deliver that. But I think there's lots of work to do to learn from other jurisdictions. The one thing that occurred to me when you were speaking about the consumer starting to take more interest in where his energy comes from, just this simple business of having real-time price and having a meter, instead of the old power meter used to, outside somewhere that you never look at your meter. You don't see those little wheels going around and measuring how much energy you're using or what it's costing you. But today with all the modern electronics and that, you have that in your kitchen and you can see, if you turn your microwave on at 6 o'clock, it's costing you more if you had real-time pricing than if you waited until 8 o'clock. A direct signal to the consumer that, how much you're consuming, and even the time of day you consume electricity, depending on what that would be, your total cost, wouldn't you get more consumer sensitive? And there are countries, New Zealand, I think, was on that kind of real-time pricing, and they actually saw a change in the consumer's behavior, actually conserving more energy than when they didn't know what it was costing or how much they were using.
Well, I think there's also some holding meter, which is just a better set. I just to share a couple of those. It fits very nicely with what you're saying. So Harris Desmond did a survey of 1,005 Canadians. This was set by telephone between July 5th and July 9th, 2012. There's, for those who are interested, there was an error interval, plus or minus 3.1% in 2020. But here are some of the interesting results. That's what they found was that Canadians identified as either top or high priority. First of all, 82% in terms of improving energy efficiency.
Conservation.
75% creating more jobs in clean energy. Reducing Canada's carbon pollution so that climate change about 66%. And reducing our reliance on fossil fuels like oil, gas, and coal, which was 66%. And what's interesting, given the debate around energy strategy that our premier has initiated in the Council of the Federation of Premiers, and where a lot of discussion about that just seems to be a much narrow sense of what a good energy policy would involve. But in this survey, only 33% placed a top priority on exporting more of Canada's oil and gas reserves. But this is what I think is most interesting, that 82% said they either strongly agreed or somewhat agreed that, quote, Canada should set aside a portion of its oil wealth to help prepare the nation for a clean and renewable energy future. So my sense is that this kind of poll, and there are other polls that are now starting to come out suggesting similar kinds of things, that at least there are aspirations in Canada, on the part of Canada, that we want to have a sustainable wanting a clean energy future, and that Canadians are looking for, and I would include Alberta, of course, would be different, are looking for some political and institutional leadership to lead the way, to start to kind of set things in motion. And yet I would imagine that many people, and certainly I feel this often, so when I look at our political leadership, I'm not inspired. I don't exploring precisely these things that the meetings are now talking about.
Well, I mean, there's always room for improving leadership in this, and the political class, this, I've got this Center for Building Democracy, you know, we raise money and try to put it into programs, we raise the intellectual, the strength of the knowledge, skills, values, ethical foundations of our political class. We particularly try to work on the conservative side, but it's quite a chore to try to do that. To be fair to the, think of the national political leadership, they do have to take into account some other factors than the ones that we're talking about tonight. When Mr. Harper and Jim Obama get together, either number one or number two on their agenda is continental energy security. That if North America got more of its petroleum resources, energy resources in general, but in particular petroleum, got more domestically than it did from other parts of the world would probably be safer. What's the U.S. and Western world going to do if Saudi Arabia goes sideways, if the Islamic fundamentals take over there and cut off that oil supply? This worry about continental energy security, one of the big things that drives the peace, what a sense of development, it's what's driving the pipeline, the Keystone pipeline demand. And they're obligated to worry about that. So when you're trying to introduce these other subjects, you've got to recognize that that's where their head at. Is that with Mr. Harper, and because he comes from Calgary here, he was a graduate of our university, did his master's thesis on whether there was a connection between the bank rate and the election cycle, which is interesting because do the central banks expand the money supply in the period immediately before election? I said, all these old professors were watching, what did he do? In his thesis, he said it was indeterminate, which was the economist's way of it. Stephen Harper he has been concerned and fixated on the economy from the first day I ever knew. He was our policy chief when he was a younger person, and his worry about this, the frailty of this economic recovery, is that's what keeps him awake. And so there's a priority to that, that, you know, not that they're not concerned about the environment or anything, but that preserving the, trying to deal with the frailty of the economic recovery, that is number one. And when the discussion with Americans, the continental energy security is popular, no matter what else is down below. Some of them are kind of late, we're talking about those concerns.
Well, I think I understand that would be certainly his motivation. The question I would have is there a better way of thinking of our economy and thinking about a resilient and more integrated energy strategy in Canada? I mean, does it not need to include energy efficiency, which Manitoba is doing wonderful things with their Bill 24, the Energy Act, the carbon pricing?
Yes, but you could be good. That was a great song to you. But Manitoba underprices its hydro. It underprices its hydro and it therefore expands consumption of so that there's contradictions within that policy.
Perhaps so, but at the same time, there's some, I think, really interesting initiatives where they're training people, and I know Sean Mooney is a candidate of these units in Winnipeg, working with people who are have barriers to employment. And what they're doing is retrofitting homes, so they're renewing the community, they're providing employment, there's an environmental side, and there's not this split between the social over here, the economic over here, the environmental over here, so there's this kind of unified thing.
Well, those are good initiatives, but you do have to be consistent. Like you can't subsidize your car on one level, which increases consumption because the prices are lower, and then use these other measures. The best way to conserve power is to raise the rates of what the real cost is. You know, so you want to be, and I guess we can give a lot of examples, you want to get some consistency in all of this, which is...
Well, I think that's why there are different provinces. If you look, in some ways, we've already got the building blocks of an effective, integrated, and resilient Canadian energy strategy. Think of the work around energy efficiency. Carbon pricing is experimental language for you. Then we have certainly feed in tariff and interest in locating power in Ontario. And we have different provinces that are kind of breaking our pioneers in particular areas. And if there's some way on a national level, but also a provincial level, that we can see all these pieces belong together, and also conservation of wetlands and revitalizing our agricultural land, there could be a really powerful approach. And I think Canadians are looking for that kind of innovative leadership.
Well, yeah, if you can find the leadership that could do that. One of the things I worry about is when we talk about these things at the macro level, people think there's nothing they can do until there's some, you know, national solution. And well, I think you want to keep searching for, you know, national integrated things. I hope that doesn't prevent people from doing the things that they can do that individually, you know, can conserve where you can conserve, reduce your demand where you can reach. If you can produce by having a windmill or a solar panel or something like that, do that. But don't wait. If you wait for Ottawa, wait for everyone. You could wait for a long time.
Well, it may happen more at provincial level, and maybe there's a way of somehow, because certainly you see this going on in Europe, and this is one of the last things I'd like to stress, maybe questions here, you have Germany, for example, cooperating with Scandinavian countries so that when they have their surplus of wind and solar energy, that's moving northward into Scandinavia. But of course, Scandinavia also has considerable assets around hydro. And so you get this stability, integrated model, not just across.
Well, you have that potential here, but the political office is doing it. It's been argued by the utility people in Alberta for years that if you integrated the hydro from BC with the thermal from Alberta, you could probably reduce the power rates and have a more aggregate, environmentally friendly power system than the way we're doing it now with the big job. But every attempt to try to integrate those systems has been resisted. And the biggest resistance has been basically from a Crown Corporation, British Columbia, that is more monopolistic than the Alberta system and just resists that system. So I agree with you, if you could integrate these things, that's one simple, relatively simple thing, but it has been talked about for 30 years and no progress. One interesting development, this may be getting off a little bit, right? You've been following maybe the BC starting to attach conditions to the Gateway pipeline, perhaps one was to be approved on the revenue side. And they're making the argument that Alberta gets more of the economic benefits, BC gets the environmental disbenefits. It's interesting that but BC has a big energy project that they eventually wanted at Site C on the Peace River. Now there the things are reversed. There's an energy project that benefits BC, the economic benefits go to BC, but the environmental effects are downstream in Alberta. Remember when BC created the WC Bennett Dam, how many years ago was that? But the negative environmental, it almost dried out the Peace River Delta for a while when they were building that reservoir. It's interesting that you've got, if again, Alberta and BC sat down together, and those two projects were put on the table, they might come to some agreement, but they'll never come when one. But I'm sort of agreeing with you that there should be more integration. It's a challenge. Yeah. Comes back to the leadership question again.
So one last thing, and I think we should question.
Yeah.
What both answers? What makes you hopeful?
Well, so one thing is the younger generation. That I think there's going to be a generation. You noticed in the oil patch, so the old decision makers, and I classify the old decision makers, somebody over 55, their idea of the economy is you got your resource extraction, you got refining, you got production, you got distribution, then you got consumption. It's a sequential thing. And then all the other is the environment. It's a tack on, it's an add on, but it's not integrated. You talk to those younger engineers, they got environment and economy, it's together at each stage. So I think there's a younger generation, not just on the business side, but on the political side, that's going to be more of a keen to these issues and willing to do something about it.
Well, I think where I find my sense of hope is that I think deep down we do want to protect our children. And I think the ways are ending is a quote from Michael Berry that in his book, Life is a Miracle, which is an interesting title in itself. Yeah. He first comes, he's a farmer, and loves the land, also comes from
a I'm familiar with the Southern Agrarians. And that's right. What you're trying to do, what Wendell was doing, right? Talk, but go and do it. That's just part of his philosophy.
So he writes in this book, and I just like to finish with this, that we know enough of our history by now to be aware that people exploit what they merely conclude to be of value, but they defend what they want.
That's a good quote there, Ron.
Well, I have to say that was really an interesting conversation, and I want to thank both of you for that dialogue. This is now the opportunity for you, the audience, to come up and ask the questions that may be on your mind, and I encourage you to use the two microphones. There's one here on my left and one on the right, and we'll go through this for a little while and look forward to hearing what you got to say. Go ahead.
Mr. Manning, when you were talking about full cost accounting, is part of what you were advocating a carbon tax?
I would never use the word tax. No, because I think it was a fundamental error made in attaching that word to, I do believe there should be a levy on carbon as one way of integrating the cost of either avoidance or mitigation of one of the principal consequences of burning hydrocarbons. I just wouldn't have called it a tax. Because, and this is why that concept got into trouble with the public, that the economists viewed the carbon tax was a mechanism for internalizing an externality. The public's view of the tax is A, they don't like it. B, it's a device, a charge on an asset or a transaction to provide revenue to the government for the revenue the government should spend on services. So I'm saying I'm in favor of the concept. I don't like the terminology. I think it's set that concept back 10, 15 years.
Follow-up question, what would you call it?
I call it,
is that conservative policy?
I call it a levy. You notice that when I was talking about full cost accounting, I call it a levy. And there's maybe some better word, but however that got into the vocabulary, it set that concept back. It set it back in this country 10 to 15 years. And the lesson in that is not just in public policy, particularly environmental policy, not just enough to have the right idea, you've got to have the communications right, or you can set an idea back a long time, not because the idea was unsound, but because of how it was communicated. There's another aside on that, but your question crosses to me. I think there's a lesson in what Gordon Campbell did in British Columbia when he instituted the carbon tax. When he first brought it up, the public opinion poll was extremely negative towards it. But you'll recall just during that time when he brought it up, the price of the commodity, oil prices, fell. So that when they introduced it, it didn't show up at the pump. The oil prices going down, so the tax was not noticeable. Now, this may sound a little Machiavellian, but I would suggest if one was introducing environmental levies or carbon tax, whatever, I would do it when the commodity prices fall, so that the impact on the consumer, the immediate impact, is not as severe, and you don't generate the political backlash that you would otherwise.
So, Mr. Manning, you just spoke to carbon pollution or energy pollution, maybe even being an externality according to what economic economists like to talk about it, and knowing that an externality is a market failure, and doing carbon pricing like Kuhnian tax or a levy, say, is preparing. empirically, I guess, if evidently the way the conservative government right now is going about it, which is not a market thing, you know, way to do it at all, being against carbon pricing, empirically, it's not a conservative thing to do, and it seems. And so, is that the case that the current federal government is not a proper green Tory, or just not a proper Tory?
Well, you know, I can't answer your rhetorical question, but I can say I think the way to change their mind is to present this concept as a market mechanism that is more complete with their basic philosophy. And the challenge is to convince them that that is in fact the case. And again, using your choice of language, you could come at somebody with these markets and propose a solution as a solution to market failure. And if there's failure is a negative term. Better to say these markets in which you have this great phase can be harnessed to achieve that. It's coming at exactly the same point that you try to get, but you don't get the guy's hackles up because you use the, well, that system in which you believe fails, and now this is the correct information. But it comes back to what I was saying before. There's a real challenge to convince conservatives that market mechanisms in which they profess to believe are actually an answer to this problem that should not be consistent.
Both of you spoke about the month place. You talked about this idea of biophilia, and you talked about your place in the cyberspace and how this connection to that. My question is about the challenge that faces Alberta today, a place which is going to throw all kinds of radical change, including huge numbers of newcomers. How can we instill a kind of deep rooted sense of place, which seems to me in some ways to be a kind of maybe a necessity for building these sorts of attachments that you were talking about in this kind of, you know, fluid, in some places, very transitory kind of population?
Do you want to start that first? I'll say something too. You're good.
Many different ways of doing that that we can see go on in our
and even here in Calgary, counting dollars, and there's all kinds of efforts to build that community. I think that's where a lot of effort needs to go. That's on a micro level. I think on a more macro level, in terms of government and economy, I think we need to put things in place that don't get in the way of people doing what they really want to do, which is to have a quality of life, to pass on to the children that sets pride about the life that we're leaving, and to feel that we're leaving a legacy rather than a plundered or an exhausted environment. And I think at the heart of all of us, no matter what age we are, I think that's a deep desire to, as Barry says, to protect what we love and to recovering that capacity that I think is very important for us.
I wish I knew what the answer to that question was. I do worry about it. Just to even in the Alberta context, a number of people come here that don't really connect with what I think Alberta is about and don't connect with it physically. That there may be something you can do to just on the educational front. I mean, Calgary isn't just a place to make money. Calgary is a prairie city on the Bow River, the Shadow, the Rocky Mountains. All three of those things are physical things that you should know about. And at the practical level, the one thing we try to do is municipal, but if everybody did it, it would help. Is when new Canadians, particularly people from other parts that aren't connected with the province country, take them and connect them. And we invite people, not very many, but we take them out to those sacred hills. There's a number of Albertans that know nothing about the sacred hills. It's one of the marvels of the parents. Well, go out there, but one of my other sons is, well, he's a medical doctor, but his love of life is fishing, and he put himself to medical school, guiding on the Bow River. So like we take people that have never been on a river before and say, this river is a priceless thing. There's 3,000 people on that. Take them, you know, take them to the mountains, take them to the Cypress Hill. Even the people that talk about Fort McMurray in the oil sands, why don't people go up there? Far more northern Alberta is kind of southern Alberta than southern Alberta. The most southern Alberta, particularly Calgarians, have never been north yet. Like, so, you know, go and be in contact with it and take some of these new folks with them. It's not the whole answer, but it's at least doing so.
I have not a question, but a quotation, and I'm going to sit down. It's two sentences. It's from 1972. It will be ironic if one of the last forms of the separation between abstracted man and abstracted nature is an intellectual separation between economics and ecology. It will be a sign that we are beginning to think in some necessary ways, but we can conceive these becoming, as they ought to become, a single discipline. I love that.
Who is that by?
Raymond Williams, he's a Marxist.
Is that good? They didn't listen to him in the Soviet Union.
Difference there.
enacted legislation 1935. When the budget of Alberta was $15 million, or $17 million, $9 million of which was debt service, and you ran the profits up for $18. And in those days, there was this sort of survival mentality that I think very much got into Alberta's DNA and political psyche, that you would never know that that happened again. Alberta was the one province that was allowed to go bankrupt. The federal government wouldn't bail out Alberta, it would bail out Saskatchewan. And that mentality that you were never going to ever experience that type of thing again, and that making heat while the sun shines, because nobody's going to take care of you if the sun goes under. I think that's an even deeper, that's partly what's behind this strong revenue maximizing view. And it's almost subconscious, like you wouldn't find a deputy minister in Edmonton or a cabinet minister that would say that, but it's part of the DNA of the problem. And maybe a first step towards breaking that is just to discuss it and get it out in the public. Why do we have this fixation with revenue maximization? My father tried it, like he was 325 years in his last 2 years in the 60s. He tried to get a dialogue going in Alberta and said, look, we have been fixated on physical resource development, and this is because of what we went through with the Great War. But at what point does that not become the object? When he tried to get the discussion on the term was not, but on the human resource development. To what end is all this economic activity? To what end is all this private enterprise or anything else? Adam Smith actually asked that question. To what end? And he tried to shift it on to human resources. It's now investments in education and health and social infrastructure. So I think that dialogue has to still be continued, but that discussion is not being held. And that, having that kind of discussion may be the first step. That's not much of an answer, but that's maybe the best thing.
I think there are some signs that there are little flickers of hope, though, that people are beginning to think about. So let me offer two quotes. First one's from David Emerson, who said in his, he's the chair of the board of names, you know, to the premier, to the cabinet. So here's the quote. We must plan for the eventuality that oil sands production will almost certainly be displaced at some point in the future by lower cost and or lower emission alternatives. We may have heavy oil to sell, but few or no profitable markets or machines buy. Now, that doesn't kind of spark something for you. Listen to Earl Premier, who at the Economic Club of Canada in Toronto said, again, I quote, it is time to stand up and show others how Canada can lead globally on all fronts, including energy supply, innovation and efficiency, as well as clean energy and addressing climate change, close quote. Now, I don't see a lot of evidence at this point that those kinds of things are being translated into policy, but I think the fact that two well-known, highly respected politicians, one our own premier and one David Anderson, have kind of looked further down the road and seen that we need to start to grapple with these ideas. We need to diversify our economy. I think that's happening just below the surface. And at the same time, I think that many energy producers or people who are thoughtful about energy production are thinking about how we produce energy and how stable is our grid, and quite concerned at how brittle and fragile and non-resilient. And have a different vision, a more distributed sense of creating energy. This idea that they developed in, you know, where you become a producer, kind of a center for almost a new environment, new energy citizenship that you see so vibrant in certainly in Germany, but many other countries as well. I think myself that that lies just below the surface, and that when you have people like David Emerson or the Premier Lysack,
take that, those kind of flickers of a new compelling vision of a new direction, to translate that into political leadership and political will, as well as helping mobilize people to passionately pursue that kind of thing, which, if the polling numbers that I mentioned earlier are correct, I think we have deep aspirations, deep hopes, and deep desires to move in that direction. And I think the rest will follow.
Well, one other thing that might, the concept behind that Alberta Heritage Savings Trust Fund is a sound concept, but I think it needs to be completely rethought. Like you remember, the concept behind the Alberta Heritage Trust Fund was Alberta should set aside a portion of its non-renewable resource revenue, invested in such a way that the stream of income from that investment would ultimately replace declining revenue from the sale of a non-renewable resource. And now that the resource wealth being produced by the oil sands is projected out for 50 or 100 years, like that concept doesn't seem to work. People just say, we don't have to save and invest it because all over these are like that will always be a stream of income from the oil sands. But if that concept was applied, why not save a portion of non-renewable resource revenue and invest it in other forms of energy so that if the day ever comes when we don't have that non-renewable, we've got an alternative. But it's a shift in the use of the Heritage Trust Fund that doesn't knock the petroleum industry, or it doesn't knock any of get as much as you can out of it, but it changes the direction and maybe a way of kind of marrying this commitment to non-renewable resource development into something else in the long term. The tragedy I've heard is never practiced the principle of that Heritage Fund, and not on sign that they're going to do it soon.
I wanted to ask about your proposal regarding reinvestment in renewable and clean technologies. And you mentioned some notable successes in other provinces. I'm wondering if you see there being a better role in trying to create those projects and programs, and whether or not that's something that you see as being on us as a purpose to try to see as maybe part of our stewardship of natural resources, or if it's really part of an issue of wealth redistribution and trying to have other Canadians perhaps see the economic benefits or see the oil sands and our resource base as not being necessarily a threat to other sectors or other parts of the economy. I just sort of puzzled over that. What's the best way that we try to create that technological base for that shift that you're talking about?
Well, I suppose there is a role for government in encouraging technological innovation, including green innovation, but the more and more I've studied it, government's efforts to create or to stimulate innovation, the more depressed and skeptical I get. I think innovating is the last thing that government's good at. And I think because they don't understand it, they don't know how to facilitate it. So I would tend to put a lot more of my eggs in the private sector basket. I think that there are going to be innovations in the direction of renewable energy, that a lot of the initiative of that is going to have to come from the private sector. And government can either get out of the way, or there are things government can do to facilitate, but don't look to government for leadership on that. And as you know, at the federal level, there's been study after study after study as to why is Canada lack on the productivity front, and then innovation is the answer. But there never seems to come a solution from government. So I would look more to the private sector and government facilitating that kind of investment, but not the Well, I think the provincial, in some respects, it depends what you do. Like in the more environmentally friendly ways of handling the petroleum industry or shipping off, it would be something that Alberta could. Hydro is more, really innovative in that area. So I think there's a big role for the provincial The federal role will mainly be on how the tax treatment of the investments in R&D. That's probably more what their role will be.
Certainly what countries in Europe, and again, I really like a lot of the work that's been done in Europe, especially in Germany, is that innovation arose from using policy tools like the median tariff, so that now you have very robust and very diversified renewable energy capacity in Europe in many different ways, and now starting to integrate with other countries like China, for example, which produces huge numbers of solar panels, and they far exceed demand in some respects, which pushed the cost down. But as the market started to adjust, what they started to see is that different countries producing and specializing and doing particular components of that. I think that's possible to do here in Alberta, and I think it's possible to do in Canada. And my sense is that innovation is not something, maybe this is what you're saying too, Preston, it's not something you can impose, but rather you can create some of the conditions where ordinary people who have pride of being not just passive consumers, but actively engaged producers of energy and communities that are producers of energy. Because after all, Germany, most of that was not produced by large corporations. It's produced by municipalities, by communities, by cooperatives with farmers, by ordinary people who just wanted to become involved in that way. And it's through that they created conditions for quite remarkable innovation, kind of from the grassroots up, rather than being imposed from the governments that are talking.
Hi. I was thinking about the question on how to mobilize social change and social action, not just the personal change, but the systematic and policymakers. And I'm wondering, often you have to bring all the sectors together, and thinking about, you talk about the business sector's role, government's role, community's role, and who's facilitating that in our province in terms of bringing those stakeholders together. You'd be thinking about, you laid out about five different solutions. Are very reasonable, and putting position keepers together, getting together with common messages would be very effective. So, as Manny and Steve talk about, creating and supporting democracy, is there an opportunity for Manny and Steve or others to be bringing these groups together, to be offering these tables and coming out with the different positions and ideas that you are both articulated, Manny? And so who is driving the leadership? To your point, often government comes up behind, they're not great at innovation. Innovation usually comes from foundations or market groups on the margins. And so how do we facilitate, and can we facilitate in Alberta, a better energy macro policy, but also encouraging Albertans to be along with the change as well as an individual
responsibility? You can try to do that by creating forums that bring these people together, and I'm a great believer in creating public pressure on these institutions, whether it's private or public, and using that to drive people together rather than just getting them in a room and hoping to keep them in there and don't feed them, they'll come up with some solution. And my political experience is in another era with respect to another issue, but something that the older folks here will. No, in the 1990s, we got to be in our bond. In fact, there was about five people got together in this town and said, we are going to make budget balance an issue for every class of government in this country. And so, some guys went with the think tank, some people created interest groups, made tax rate federation, we created a political party, and got enough rank and file people to sort of ask for one simple thing. Balance your books. I have to, what can you? And yet, I know we've created enough pressure that the public policy makers had to respond. And I think it's probably be a combination of what you say. You try to get together the main sector, but you can get the public behind some, like full cost accounting, maybe too much of a cost balance, ecological budget, maybe too far a leap, but you can get public pressure behind, so the groups have to respond to it. And we never got enough members to have a parliament to balance the federal budget, but we took enough votes away from enough other people that they said whether we believe it or not, we better go to. And that combination of getting the right various players together, the public pressure to come up with some solution, I do think that's a very important. Well, I think the challenge for the environmental groups then is to form a coalition that can focus on one or two things that would move it along. And then this is kind of what happened. I mean, it kind of balanced the budget. You had business people that they just wanted to get the balance to get the taxes down. You had property people that wanted it for another reason. You had economists that had theoretical reasons why the budget should be but they would probably disagree on that. I don't think that the thing in coalition building is you find people and you actually talk like this. You say, look, we disagree on all this. Are we not agreed on these three things? And will we not agree to work together to get these three things and then we'll go our separate ways? There's a need for that kind of leadership, I think, in the environmental movement because you say it's very much fragmented and then it loses that.
In my sense, is that the political right has been better at doing exactly what you just described, and finding or two or three things we can agree on, let's put together, than the progressives or whatever you want to say. And I think there's a lot that all of us can learn from that. But I do like your idea of a coalition, and I think your point too, Lana, around how do you build those connections. I think it comes in a couple of ways. One is, I think there's certainly needs of out and find out who are the people within government, so it's both elected people in our caucus, in the Conservative caucus, but also all political parties, who are friends of it. So maybe in Winnipeg, for example, we could have found out that there's one NDP member, and he's in government, we know that, but he's quite keen on the environment. But the other person, who's in the opposition, is Conservative, developed a feed-in tariff for his community of agricultural community in Manitoba. So I think there are people in all the parties that can be drawn together, so I think that needs to happen. I think the question of does our current government have the capacity to, even if they decided, like if overnight, Alison Redford said, we're going to become a leader of green energy. I think there's open questions to whether our government exists even has that capacity. That would be second. I think the third thing is, are there clusters of where people can find common interests? So, for example, we have almost 75% of our energy, the energy that's lighting up the room and making my microphone work, is produced by coal. But we have a large province of Ontario, which by the end of 2014 will have removed all the coal off stream. Now, they've got a variety of other things, they've got hydro, they've got nuclear, which has its own problems, which you've already pointed out earlier. And of course, they're just trying to develop their renewables as well, quite aggressively, under the current government. But I think to look at, are there problems with the way that we produce our energy? Most people don't even know that we have coal, such a big part of their health impacts. And it's interesting, in on CBC, with an interview with the energy minister of Ontario, the health minister, he said that the tipping point for Ontario was the health impacts on families, communities, and children. Asthma, lung problems, this was about 3 or 4 weeks ago. So are there different, and there are really other rallying points too. There are many business people who are trying to get their businesses running. Are there ways that they could be supported? I'm biased, mind you, because I come from the university, but I think actually universities have a role to play in bringing people together, have through round tables of bringing those points of view, constructing offering a compelling positive vision, but also looking for practical and constructive solutions of ways to go, drawing on the experience of not only other provinces but other countries, and then somehow developing those into the plan.
Thank you. Mr.
Manning,
I'm appreciate your point about conservation and conservatism being not irreconcilable, but and the economy and the environment. But I'm still having trouble reconciling your talk about balancing budgets and us, to me, reconciling the natural monetary logic to kind of internalizing market mechanism, when the balancing of budget of the new environment is something quite different. I mean, if we think about Andrew before his provocative metaphor of energy slaves, where all of us in North America have on average 89 slaves working for us on a daily basis. That, to me, is fundamentally at odds with the logic of balancing one's budget. And does demand-side management even begin to sort of evoke the kind of shift that we need to think in terms of oil-based market or capitalism as opposed to another kind of system?
Yeah, I guess I was sort of coming at it from 90,000 feet, and you're maybe trying to, you know, bring it down lower. I'm just saying my thought was where there was a parallel and compatibility is the principle in balancing budget is that you have to live within your means. Ultimately, you have to live within your means. You cannot spend more, you cannot output more than ultimately you take in. And that concept at that level is the same. It really is an ecological concept and applied. I think at that level, there's a compatibility between balancing budgets and balancing fiscal budgets and balancing ecological budgets. But I think maybe what you may be getting at now, how you balance that budget on the fiscal side, if you do it by slashing every social expenditure or environmental protection fee that the government is doing, well, that's counter to trying to achieve conservation. But at that level of principle, I think it's the same. The way I was using it is trying to convince people to say, like, I'm committed to living within my means, and they need it in this fiscal sense to try to extend that to the broader area. It may have its limitations as an argument. Yeah. Well, my partial answer to that is this full cost accounting. If energy was priced at its true cost, which is not just the cost of producing the energy, but the cost of applying to mitigate the environmental consequences of producing that energy, there's no better device for reducing demand than the price. Charge more, people use less.
Okay, well, sorry, to interrupt that. This will be the last question, and we'll wrap things up. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. This is going to be the last question, actually. I couldn't address a general question with respect to what Dr. Lysack talked about, and Mr. Manning talked about. I think it's being in Calgary, a very interesting situation. All I can tell is that I'm one of those European immigrants came to Calgary for mountains. That was my main motivation, basically. And I'm actually escaping from density, living in a city, however, prefer living in countryside. But so what I'm recognizing is, I think as an industrial humanity, we are into extravagancy, and most solutions we are offering intimate, like sustainability, which I simply oppose, and renewable energy and other stuff, it's like, you know, these solutions have a tendency to enable our extravagant lifestyle rather than the natural world to survive a little longer. So realistically, how do you assess this? That will be my question.
I'm glad you say the easy questions. I guess I would come at it from this point of view that I'm quite taken with the kind of vision that someone like Chris Turner has in his book Geography of Hope and more recent book called The Leap. And I certainly would recommend, I'm sure a lot of people read one or maybe both of those books, I would encourage people to take a look at it, because I think what his vision is it's not so much a matter of breaking the addiction. very easy things that don't require massive changes, but allow people the opportunity to actually enter into the life they really want for themselves, for their family, most particularly for their children. So thinking again of you mentioned dense cities, well, I think density can be a good thing. I mean, sometimes it means bringing people together, people hanging out in cafes and stuff like that. Whereas here, we're prevented by their infrastructure. We're dependent on living in a certain kind of way. And I'm convinced that the more people experience this more positive, deeper life rather than a shallow life, in the sense of just staying confined within a certain boundary and not enjoying that quality of community, that community. I think that as we experience that, we'll feel that very natural pull. Is that releasing us from our addiction? Probably. I mean, addiction is a strong word, but it probably describes some of our resistance and inertia. And yet, that's what people have done, and there have been like massive rioting in the streets of, say, Copenhagen, where they eliminated cars from the core, where 40% of people get to work by bicycle. And I think it's that kind of positive, compelling vision that I think inspires to actually do it. I think Calgary has the know-how, has the experience and the desire to move in that direction if you provide the means and the tools.
I thought what you were saying, I may have misunderstood it, but if all technological innovation does is make it easier for us to demand more, or meet our increasing demands, it's not solving this problem. So the technological innovation, much of it should be on the other side as to how to reduce our demand rather than how to facilitate.
Well, great. Thank you, both of you. Very good. Entertaining evening. I'm going to invite Robert back here to address. So.
Well, first of all, I think we need to give a great round of applause.
Thank you.